Hey, how's it going, guys? It's Nate here. And as SKSE users learned the hard way, just today, or perhaps a couple of days ago, depending on when this video goes live, Skyrim's Creation Club received yet another wave of creations on its marketplace. 5 in total, with prices ranging from 100 to 750 credits. And as always, I've taken the liberty of purchasing each and trying them out for a few hours so no one else has to, unless they want to. And I'm actually fairly satisfied with most of what this season brought, but I'll let the content speak for itself. We'll be assessing all of the new creations individually in ascending order in terms of price. So, without further ado, let's do further. Starting off, for just 100 Bethesda bucks, is Alternative Armors, Stolrim. This creation, or mod, or micro DLC, or whatever it is you'd like to call it, is one of two content offerings that came with this wave for only 100 credits that adds in a new armor set. This one in particular is adding in Stolrim Fur Armor. To get your hands on it, or to get it on your hands, all the player needs to do is head on over to an abandoned camp near the Skull Village on Solstheim. There will be a dead Skull Nord, as well as his journal, which will lead us to a small iceberg where the armor can be found sitting inside of a coffin. Be careful though, because it will be fiercely protected by a very unfriendly Reaver. Though once he's been dealt with, the armor's all yours. The full set boasts a much heavier appearance than the typical Skull armor, with more plates and cloth elements, though its most distinguishing visual characteristic is the closed helmet, which looks pretty cool if you ask me. As a complete set, the armor offers 119 points of damage protection. For context, normal Stolrim heavy armor has a rating of just 102, and Dragonscale armor, the otherwise best in the game, is good for only 111 points of damage protection. So this apparel is certainly going to keep you as safe as any other. Overall, I'm pretty satisfied with this purchase. My biggest criticism of other Creation Club armor offerings has been their seemingly large pricing in exchange for so little content. Though with a price tag of just 100 credits, an amount that many players may even already have in their wallet without buying anything, seen as Bethesda's just given away credits before, I think this is absolutely worth it. Sure, it's a very small amount of content, but it's also an exchange for a very small amount of money. So I believe this is pretty reasonable. We've certainly seen worse. Next up, also for 100 immersion points, is a very similar creation to the last one, Alternative Armors, Dwarven Mail. This introduces Dwarven Mail as a new armor set. To find it, simply follow the quest marker that will automatically manifest once you've loaded into a game, which will lead you to yet another abandoned camp. Here the remains of a dead Bosmer Arena Fan can be found. Clearly a nod to a familiar character from The Elder Scrolls IV Oblivion, on his body will be a journal that explains he came from Cyrodiil to meet one of his favorite arena champions that happens to live in Skyrim, and is apparently known for his unique set of armor. He mentions the gladiator in question has a bit of a rep for not being kind to fans, but this wood elf is sure that's all just nonsense hearsay. Now, it's implied that very arena champion killed this fan, so clearly he should have taken those rumors more seriously. But no matter, after reading the diary, we'll be given a new quest marker to meet this famed gladiator for ourselves. When we finally find him, he'll be donning that special set of armor, though we'll be very hostile. Defeat him in battle, and that protective clothing will be all yours. The appearance speaks for itself. Much like that previous Stolrim set we just went over, this looks a lot more bulky than the normal Dwemer armor it's based on. I again found the helmet to be especially impressive. Accumulatively, you should get about 95 points worth of damage protection with this full kit, shield notwithstanding. So, not quite as good as the Stolrim, but still an effective outfit, even later on in the game. There's not much more to add here. Another dollar, another similar content offering. Personally, I'm again pretty satisfied with this. Alright, now we take a pretty big leap in price. Our third CC edition that came with this wave is Dawnfang and Dustfang, which will set you back 500 credits, or 5 times the last one. At its core, this is a sword mod. However, it comes alongside a rather elaborate, at least by Creation Club standards, side quest necessary to obtain the new item, That should take a good 15 to 45 minutes, depending on how much reading you decide to do, and whether or not you pursue a side objective. But more on that later. Once a game has been loaded into, the Dovahkiin will be sent to inspect some strange rumblings coming from Riften's ratways. Here, you'll eventually stumble upon a series of notes and journals, telling the tale of a now-dead couple who were once in love. Your hunt of these notes will lead you into an entire new section of the sewers, about the size of a dungeon. Here, floating in the center of it all, will be a special blade. However, before that blade can be accessed, we'll first have to clear out three different chambers in this dungeon, each containing a few skeletons and a different version of a powerful ghost. Once that's all done, though, it appears for whatever reason, the angry spirits will be put to rest, and the sword will be all ours. Now, the interesting thing about this object is it's actually sort of like two separate blades. You see, by day, or more specifically between the hours of 5 a.m. and 6 p.m, it's called Dawnfang. The gem in the center of it is litten up like fire, and it has a special enchantment that allows it to do 7 points worth of fire damage. However, at night, or between 6 p.m. and 5 a.m, its name changes to Duskfang. Its gem darkens, and now it does 7 points of frost damage. This was rather cool, because I don't believe there's any other item in the game that actually changes like this while it's in your inventory. No matter the time, though, the sword will always have a base damage of 17, a weight of 16, and a value of 2,449 gold. Additionally, regardless of whether it's day or night, your weapon also has an enchantment that allows you to absorb an extra 5 points of magicka for every 12 creatures killed. So, that's pretty nice. That about does it for the core of what this mod offers. But as I alluded to, there's also a sort of side objective you can go after. While in that new dungeon, you can find a note that will tell the tale of another sword, called Bloodthirst, which can be found at Broken Fang Cave. Once you've completed the main quest, you can go over to that specific cave and find this special sword too. Bloodthirst has the same model, texture, and base stats as the other sword, or swords, but doesn't change names or appearances depending on the time, and its enchantment allows you to absorb 15 points of health per swing, which is also quite useful. So, in a way, this mod kind of introduces up to 3 different swords. Overall, I found myself pretty impressed with the quest this creation offered. I feel like while the blades were definitely cool, it was really that elaborate questline that made Bethesda comfortable with setting the price tag at about $5. However, the value proposition seems a lot less enticing than the last two creations we looked at. So, while I think a lot of Skyrim fans will get their money's worth with this one, I have trouble giving Dawnfang and Duskfang as firm of an endorsement as the last two. But it's still cool. The fourth creation, priced at 600 credits, is Netch Leather Armor. This introduces a new tier of armors, fashioned from the skin of netches, those big floating tentacle things on Solstheim. Now, the armor actually comes in 3 sets, and there's some variation in the exact styles of helmets and shields that I'll get into shortly. But first, I think we should discuss the associated quest this mod also comes with. Once installed, you'll be given a marker to go investigate a campsite on Solstheim. There, the Dragonborn will find the corpse of a Dunmer peddler, likely murdered to death by some nearby horkers. And in his inventory will be a journal that describes his recent adventures. Apparently, the man had been trading with a nearby tribe of Reichlings. He learned that the little goblins really enjoyed the taste of a material called netch leather, which is similar to cow leather, it just comes from netches instead. The problem here is, netch leather is apparently very poisonous, and consuming too much of it can be very fatal. So, the peddler hatched a plan. He began selling the Reichlings normal cow leather, simply dyed to look as though it came from netches. This ensured the little smurfs didn't just all kill themselves, and that the peddler still had some active paying customers. Seems like a pretty sweet deal, that was unfortunately interrupted by those horkers. After discovering this scene and reading the diary, we'll be given a new objective to go investigate that nearby Reichling camp. Here, much to our surprise, we'll find the Reichlings are entirely friendly. Speak to their leader, and he'll give you a note. Or, really, a drawling, because, you know, he can't talk. Which essentially communicates, his tribe currently has a hunting party out pursuing an entire family of Netches, and he wants your help. From here, believe it or not, you actually have a few options. There's A, the path of least resistance, go rendezvous with that hunting party and help them kill the bull Netches, which is clearly meant to make you feel bad for the poor animals because they are a cute little family, but in exchange you'll be given some cool loot by the Reichlings, as well as access to the three new armor types this creation offers. Or, at the very least, learn how to craft them, completing the short quest. Going this route will get you the new items the fastest, but surprisingly enough, if you return to the Reichling camp a few days later, they'll all be dead, having consumed the poisonous Netch meat, which is pretty tragic, but a nice little touch by Bethesda. Option B is to craft some fake Netch leather, similar to what the peddler was doing, and give that to the Reichling chief. This seems to be the good guy option, as it will get the leader to call off his hunting party, sparing that entire Netch family, ensuring his tribe doesn't poison itself, and still earning you all the new armor. So everyone ends up happy, but you gotta do a little extra work. Finally, option C is to just attack and kill all of the Reichlings at this camp, and then go massacre the hunting party. This will keep that adorable Netch family alive, but you'll of course also lose your Reichling friends, and you'll have to just dig up the crafting recipes and make all of that new armor from the ruins of their camp. No matter the route you choose though, it doesn't seem to impact whether or not you can access all the new content, just how fast you'll get your hands on some of it. As if left alive and helped, the Reichlings will give you a few pre-made sets. Otherwise, you'll have to, again, get the materials and craft them for yourself. Nonetheless, we've dwelled on this quest long enough. What about all this new apparel I keep talking about? Well, as mentioned, there are three new tiers available. Each can be crafted at a bench, or, again, just rewarded depending on how you pursued the mission. There's regular Netch leather armor, painted Netch leather armor, and shadowed Netch leather armor. There's not a tremendous difference in terms of stats between these tiers. It's mainly just about what it takes to craft them and how they look. Furthermore, as you can probably tell, there's also two different helmet types you can choose from. One being more of an open hat, and the other a much cooler looking closed full face mask that I greatly prefer. There's also some variation in the shield and chest pieces as well. Out of everything we saw today, I'd argue this creation achieves the best balance of a fun quest plus a decent chunk of new content added in. This is the first creation that gives the player some real agency and choice in its accompanying quest, which was definitely neat, though I will say with these Creation Club quests, it's pretty unfortunate that Bethesda won't say whether or not they're canon, or if they're of any significance in the Elder Scrolls' greater narrative. Because if they're not, from a story standpoint, these are all pretty much meaningless. Though if they are, Bethesda's really messed up the game's lore with some of these. Either way, I felt pretty happy with this one. $6 is certainly on the pricier side of things though, so act with caution. And finally, the last creation added to Skyrim's marketplace today, for 750 credits, is the Expanded Crossbows Pack. Simply put, this mod establishes 8 new crossbows in the otherwise crossbow-deprived world of Skyrim. There's Orcish, Silver, Nordic, Glass, Stolarim, Daedric, and Dragonbone tier bows. They each come with a custom model and texture, and depending on the tier, their damage rating ranges from just 20 points all the way up to 90. Now, right off the bat, I'm gonna say this one probably isn't worth your Bethesda buckaroos. For one, unlike all the other creations we've seen so far, there isn't any quest necessary to access all this new content. It's all purchasable from the Fletcher shop in Solitude, or can be crafted at the appropriate station. Which is odd, seeing as the last two we've covered had some pretty unique missions that we got to complete, on top of all of the new items. And both Dawnfang and Netch leather armor were considerably cheaper than this. Heck, I think the leather armor creation even offered more unique items in total anyway. I mean, don't get me wrong, the quality of what the expanded crossbows pack is offering is pretty solid, even by CC standards. Everything looks great, the artist did a phenomenal job, and if this were a free mod, I'd be all over it. But it's not a free mod. It costs $7.50, more than the entire Hearthfire DLC. It's almost like you're paying a dollar per crossbow. When, remember, a dollar could also get you a full set of pretty bad A-looking armor. A much more reasonable price tag for something like this, in my opinion, would have been around 300 credits. But for what it's asking now, this is really the only creation we've looked at today that I'm going to objectively tell you to avoid. It's just not really worth it. Anyway, that about does it for us for now. While we certainly ended on a bit of a sour note, I think most of these creations were a step in the right direction. The cheap armor sets were excellent. I recall explicitly stating, when covering earlier Creation Club waves, that if they could just release some cheaper content, it could really be good for the service. And Bethesda did just that. The additional quests offered by the Dawnfang and Netch armor creations were also some of the best we've seen so far. Though the whole ambiguity regarding whether or not this stuff is canon at all places a major asterisk above everything. Again though, a fairly solid season, and Bethesda has stated in some community posts that the next wave will perhaps be the biggest ever, so I'm very interested in what that exactly means. Anyway, we're about out of time here. Thanks for watching, everyone. What are your thoughts on what we saw today? Do you agree, disagree with my perspectives thus far? Leave a comment down below. As always, like ratings are very much appreciated. Again, thanks for stopping by, and I hope to catch you all in my next video. Peace out, everybody.